actually, if you see that video, then you will understand what is a case study exam and what you need to do to pass the case study exam. Okay. So I'm saying in very short, what is a case study exam, what we need to do in these coming 1 month, approximately around 28 days. And if we follow that, then we can easily pass this exam. Since you are already working, you have practical exposures. At the same time, you have given the three subject exam, E1, P1, F1. So you have good knowledge and understanding of the three subjects also. Not line by line, which is also not required, but you have studied those three subjects. A case study exam is of 3 hours exam. It's not 90 minutes. When you will be sitting in the exam hall, total time allowed will be 3 hours and 15 minutes. First 15 minutes, the modality of the software which you get in OTQ exam also, that they will be telling what you can do, what you can't do in the software in the exam. And then you will be writing the answers in 3 hours. In those 3 hours, you will be given either 4 or 5 questions. Generally, they are giving 4, but sometimes they give 5 questions also. Now, there is no objective type. For every question, you need to type your answers after the question. There will be a question paper which will open in front of you. There will be some write-up relating to that, 1 or 2 pages. And then on the basis of that write-up, you need to write your answers. Then one question is over, then second will start. For every question, there is a designed time. For every question, there is a fixed time frame. When you will sit in the exam hall, on the first screen, you will be getting this type of table. Suppose I am saying that there are 4 questions. For every question, they are generally giving 45 minutes. So 45 into 4, total 180 minutes, 3 hours. Now, when the first question will open, reading the question, writing the answer, planning the answers, everything, you will be given exactly 45 minutes. Once 45 minutes is over, you will be forced to go into the second question. You cannot take more than 45 minutes, even single second, in a question which is given first. You cannot go back to that. You are forced to go to the second one. Whatever you have written, that is already submitted. The reason for this type of exam structure is that when we are working in the organization and your boss asks you to do something, say in 1 hour, say in 2 hours, you need to submit the report within that period. Once you submit it, that's done. Maybe you will be given another work, another assignment after that, but the work which you have submitted is done. Similar, they want to say that in the exam, you are not giving exam, you are working in an organization, and whatever the task given by your boss, you need to complete those tasks within the given time frame, with revision, with everything. So they are saying that when the exam students are sitting in the exam hall, they will be given a designated time for each task, for each part. Once that time is over, the solution is automatically submitted. The first question will take, say, 45 minutes, given 45 minutes. You completed that in 40 minutes. You want to do the second one, you can do. You can submit the answer before 45 minutes and you can start the second one. But once you have submitted, you cannot go back. And the second thing, the 5 minutes which you have saved, you cannot use in the second question. The first question, if you complete earlier, you cannot carry forward the time which you saved in the next question. So in the exam, it is advisable not to submit any question before the time allotted. At the same time, those who are giving exams, say 100 students, out of 100, nobody says that he completed the answer in less than 45 minutes. So it's a challenge to complete the answer in the given time. So that question does not arise if you complete earlier and you want to submit earlier, whether I should submit or not, because you will never be able to complete earlier. So for that reason, the time is a constraint and we need to write our answers full 45 minutes. Even though if we complete earlier, we should revise what we have written. And once 45 minutes is over, then only the answers would be submitted automatically. Like that, they will be giving generally four questions. Earlier, they used to say that in 2015, there will be four or five questions. In some papers, they given five questions, but now they have made a standard. They are giving four questions, every question equal time, equal marks, and we need to answer for all the questions. The paper will be of 150 marks, just like you have 150 marks in the OT questions also. Here the pass marks is not 100. Here the pass marks is 80, 20 marks less. Out of 150, we need to score 80 to pass the exam. But there is a story relating to this 80 marks. On the basis of the pre-seen material, is in relation to a gym company. That company have gym centers at many places in a particular city. People join the gym, they make their body health and all that, that the company is doing. You will read that material. We will be reading in the class also. We will understand what the company is doing, what are their challenges, what are the opportunities, then how the company do their business, their organization structure, their directors, their financial statement, their competitors, what the company can do, what problem the company can face, everything we will discuss in the class. On the basis of that material, Institute prepares five sets of question papers. Five sets of question papers are treated at five variants. In Institute language, the question papers are treated as variant. Variant 1, variant 2, variant 3, variant 4, variant 5. So there are five variants. When the student give exam and he is sitting on the computer screen, when he click start, any one variant will pop up. It may be variant 1 also, it may be 2 also, it may be 5 also, any one variant. But all the variants questions are not of the same standard. Some variant questions are slightly tricky, difficult. Some variants questions are easier and some variants are mediocre, average. If you are giving exam and suppose you got the difficult variant and I am giving exam, I got the easier variant, there is no benefit to me because I need to score marks more to pass and there is a benefit to you. You need to score less to pass the exam. Suppose for your variant, the institute has decided that the weightage will be 110%. So whatever marks actually you will score, they will multiply your marks with 110%. Suppose you score 75, multiplied by 110%. So it is coming 82.5, 83, you are passed. Suppose I scored 90, but for my variant, the weightage is 85%. So 90 into 85% is less than even 80. So I will be declared fail. So depending upon the toughness or the level of variant, the weightage is decided. That weightage we don't come to know. Even for the past papers also, they have not set the weightage to us. That is only known to the institute. The team of faculties, head examiners decide what should be the percentage, how we can say that the variant is difficult and easy, and the student get weighted average marks. So if those weighted average marks is 80 or greater than 80, then the student will pass. So it's not that we can say 80 by 150, 53%. In difficult variant, it is even 45% is the pass marks. In an easy variant, even 55% is not giving you the pass marks, or 60% may not be giving you the pass marks. So we need to score weighted average marks 80 to pass the exam. The second thing, in the exam, when the student is writing the answers, They are testing four types of skills: technical skill, business skill, people skill, leadership skill. They are saying that in operational level, out of 150 marks, 64% is technical skill marks, 16% is business skill marks, 14% is people skill marks, and 6% is leadership skill marks. What is technical skill? Technical skill is knowledge of subject E1, P1, F1, whatever is written in the book. Business skill means application of that knowledge relating to gym fit, relating to the industry. That is, book is knowledge is not sufficient. You need to apply that knowledge according to the practical environment, that is in the case study which is given. People skill is 14%, communication. If you are talking to your colleague, communicating with your colleague, your boss, or outside agencies, suppliers, customers, how you should talk. If you are talking to an engineer, if you are discussing with an IT person, they have never studied accounts and finance, but you should be communicating in such a way that they should understand what do you want to say. So communication should be your strength. And leadership. Generally, in, I can say, operational level, they have written leadership is 6%. But leadership things are very less in the questions. What is leadership? Lead from the front. What is lead from the front? Who will be doing what? When can be done what? And whatever you are saying, others are accepting, not because of the position you, because of the thing, because of your knowledge. So leadership, generally in operational level, not there because we are operational level staff. We get the instructions from the leaders like managers. So generally the leadership skill is less. But anywhere, if you want to recommend anything, that you need to, you are asked to decide something, who will be doing what, those things can be correlated with the leadership skill. So all the total paper, all the five variants will have this proportion. Now 150 into 64% is around 95 marks. Out of 95, you need to score at least 1/3. 95 into 1/3, say 32. In business skill, 150 into 16%, say around 25. In 25, you need to score 1/3, 8.33. In people skill, 150 into 14%, again say around 22, 23, you need to score 1/3. In each of the skill, the student need to score at least 1/3. If he is scoring in any of the skill less than 1/3, it is called in that category fail. If he is scoring 1/3 to 2/3, it is called moderate. If he is scoring greater than 2/3, it is called super. So even though maybe your total marks is greater than the weighted average, but in leadership skill you get less than 1/3, the results will be fail. There are students whom we have taught, scored 92, one student Divya. She is giving now strategic case study. She gave exam operational level around in 2017 beginning. So she will be giving the strategic case study. In operational level, she failed. She got 92, and in business skill, it was failed. So it's not only 80. The student need to score in all the skills 1/3, 1/3, 1/3. Many times in operational level, in management level, in strategic level case study, students are scoring between 60 to 80. In all the skills, they are moderate. Technical moderate, business moderate, people moderate, leadership moderate. But they are not getting 80. They are complaining. Sir, aapne to moderate bola tha. I said moderate means 1/3 to 2/3. Suppose in all the skills, you are getting 40% marks. Moderate. But 150 into 40% is 60 only, not 80. Why you are not getting that adequate marks? The questions requirement you have not written properly. Proper points are not covered. Length of the answer was small. These may be the reasons. Or maybe you are a good student. Sometimes we have seen that some bad luck happened. A student got 78. Bad luck means during the time of exam, you are a good student. You worked hard, but during the time of exam, you have not been able to perform that level. Maybe your points which you have covered is not proper, or the length of the answer was short. But getting 60 to 80 means the student is good, but some bad luck, or he has not properly written the answers. Those who are good students, generally 99% they pass, who follow the instruction which I will give. As I said, in the OT question, same thing here. We are teaching since 2015 all the operational management strategy case study. And I have seen that in the class only student know who will pass, who will not pass. It's not that when the exam is given and the result will be out, the student will pass or not. In the class only, when the classes are getting finished, a student know that whether they will pass or not. Me also, a student also. We are going to conduct 7 to 8 classes. In the first two class, today and the next class, we are going to cover the pre-seen material, industry, correlation of the material with E1, P1, F1, certain themes which they can give in the exam, that we will discuss. In the next class, I will give you some mock questions also, not for answering from whom, we will discuss that answers in the class only. From third class, I will start giving you the question paper. Third and fourth class, I will give you the question paper. You need to write the answers in a word file named as, say, Diksha, Mock 1, say, Arpan, Mock 1, make a word file. And all the questions, answers, you will write in that file, word file, typing on the internet, money, word file, and then mail me. While writing the answers, you can refer all the books, you can refer Google, anything you want. Don't focus on timing, just write the answers very lengthy. Go into detail of every aspect, 360 degree. We will discuss those answers in front of you in the class only. After the third and fourth class is over, I will give you further mock papers for coming classes. Those mock paper answers, you will write without referring anything. Without referring E1, P1, F1, without referring East, Google, anything. And you will write those answers in 3 hours only. In fourth class also, fifth class also, sixth class also, seventh class also. Continuously, you will be writing only 3 hour answers and mailing me. You will find that you are continuously improving in every class. So by that time, the last class will come, exams done come. You will feel that you are pretty well enough to pass the exam. Initially, when you write the answer, you will find that you are not writing good, but with the practice, you will improve. So those who write the answers in the class, there is a 90% chance that those students pass. Bad luck may happen. But those who don't write the answers, there is a 100% that they will not pass the exam. I can say, not 90. So there are students who complain that I didn't get time and all that. Suppose you are not doing the live class on Monday. Not a problem. Submit the answers. We will discuss your answer in the class. So when you will be doing the recording, then you will be able to refer how you need to improve. That practice need to be done by every student to pass the exam. If they are not doing that, then it is difficult to pass this exam. Are you getting what I'm saying? You are busy. I can understand you are working, but you need to write the answers for the mock papers, which I will be giving you for the third class onwards. That's the only difference between a student passing and not passing the exam. Can you just give me 4 minutes? Can we take a break of 4-5 minutes? Just 4-5 minutes. So what I was saying that, we will study pre-seen material today and next class, and then we will be going with the mock papers. Okay. As far as how to write the answers, the format which they are saying, when reading the section, make sure understanding the different requirements in the section. Requirements might be given clearly in bullet points, although in some sections, the requirements may be included within paragraphs. It is important for you to pick all the requirements before you start the answer. You see that, suppose there is a question paper in the first screen. First section, one task. Second section, one task. Third section, two task. What is the meaning of this two task? Two task means that, suppose there is a write-up. Then they are asking one question. You have written the answer. Again, there is one more question. And then you will write the answer, and then the entire thing is finished. I mean to say, suppose I am talking about the company is purchasing an asset. How it should be treated for? How it will be accounted for? You write the answers. Then in the same question only, once we will purchase the asset, we need to train our staff, how we can train, motivate and all that to run the assets. That you are writing in the next question. That whole thing is section 3. Sometimes it happens that, like section 1, one question, which means that relating to that scenario, relating to that write-up, all questions are asked at once. In every question, there will be 2-3 things they will be asking. If we can understand exactly what they are asking, we will pass at least 80% probabilities there. But if we are not understanding exactly what they are asking, then we will fail again at least 80% probability. That is the major issue with operational level and sometimes management and strategic level student. Suppose the question is relating to ABC. You started writing everything relating to ABC, activities, division and all that, drivers. But they are not asking all the thing. They are asking only that what can be the drivers of the activities. But you started explaining ABC. So there are many things which you are writing which is not relevant for the question. So we need to read the question very carefully and need to write the answers relating to the requirement. Don't write anything which is not asked, because you will not get time also. Understanding the requirement is most important part in case study questions. When starting the answers, include subheadings of the different requirements of the section. This way you will be able to manage time before, since brain creates awareness on the subsection that you need to address while typing the answer. When you will write the answers, you need to write the answers in small, small paragraph. Like here, small, small paragraphs are written. Don't have to say bullets. In place of these bullets, above the paragraph, you can make a heading, which is called subheading. Suppose you are writing about whether the companies would apply activity-based costing or not. Suppose. Now we say that for application of activity-based costing, there are certain criteria. One, the overhead expenditure should be very high. So you can make a heading, overhead expenditures. You write two, three lines, four lines about that. Then the next heading is about overhead expenditure depends upon drivers. So different drivers, you make another paragraph. Then the third line, you can make the activity. So I mean to say, they are saying that if you make subheadings for each paragraph, it will be better, so that you can concentrate that this you are writing. And you need to write around, you can say 8 to 10 paragraphs in every question. The length of the answer should be around 1.5 pages. In 45 minutes, you need to type 1.5 pages for each question answer. So your answer sheet will be around 6 to 7 page answers. Do not proceed to the next section until the allocated time for the current section is over. If you have typed all the essential points of the current section, make sure you read through your answer again. Most of the time there may be mistakes which you can correct, as well as new points may be added. Even though the time is left, don't go into the next section. Utilize full time. In some sections there may be two different parts, and this is the case. You will have two different windows to type. The number of parts in a section will be notified before you start the exam. Note that fourth questions are referred to as section in the exam, whereas the parts are referred to as task. 1, 4, 2, 3, 4 section, but in the third section there are two tasks. If we don't remember that, and suppose the third section we are, one question we read, we are writing the answer. We taken full 45 minutes into that, and the second we have not answered at all. So see, check in the first only that there are two parts which I need to answer in two windows. Before you start for first section, write down the amount of time allocated for each section in the erasable notepad. I will not say, you can write. Generally, when nowadays they are giving question, all questions have 45 minutes. Earlier it was more important. If you find that the timing is different, you can note down that. Leave two lines blanks between paragraph. You can see this paragraph, then this paragraph. There is a gap. The examiner gets a smaller screen with your answers. And leaving a space between paragraphs makes it clear, and examiner understand that you have written different things. Include a minimum 2 sentences, maximum 4 sentences per paragraph. Past variant solutions be a reliable source for you to judge the content of the paragraph. If you go in CIMA.com, CIMAglobal.com and CIMA Connect, use your ID and password there in CIMA Connect. You can see in OCS past term papers. Don't go into detail of that, because then you need to study the industry also. Any one term past paper, see the 5 variants and see the answers, what they have written, how they are giving the questions, how they are writing the answers. But in case study, there is no wrong or right answer. They have written in each answer sheet, this is not the only answer. But they are not accepting any challenge for their answers. The student can have, or anybody can have, a different view, and their answers is also correct. So in case study, there is no wrong or right answer. Everything is correct only. If you are giving logic, justification, yours is correct. I am giving logic justification. My views are different. I am also correct. So we need to think about logical explanation. Make sure you apply every point to the company in the pre-seen, unseen, even highly technical task. The examiner has made it very clear that marks would be awarded only for answers applied within the context of the scenario. You cannot write anything which we studied in E1, P1, F1 only. You need to correlate with the pre-seen material and write many things from the pre-seen material also to write the answers. The scratch pad in the screen and the erasable notepad, which you see that when you have given OTQ exam, there is a scratch pad on a screen. There is physically scratch pad also. Don't write anything into that. Write everything on your main answer sheet. So maybe if you are getting short of time, the examiner will read that. When planning the answer, include in the main answering book only. Gradually expand the points. This will save your time, and in case you fall short of time, the examiner will give you marks on that. Spend between 20 to 30% total time regarding content and planning the answer, and use the remaining time to elaborate your answer. We can say that 45 minutes you are getting. In 45 minutes, say 20%, 9 minutes, 10 minutes. You will read the question, you will read the scenario, you will read the requirement, you will think what should be, you should be writing, what are the answers, logical answer for this, then you will type for 35 minutes. And in 35 minutes, every minute you should be able to type 1.5 lines. So in 35 minutes, you will be able to type greater than 50 lines. If you write proper length of answer, then you will get the great proper marks. While typing, while writing, if there is grammatical mistake, if there is a spelling mistake, there is no penalty, no deduction of marks. But even though with the grammatical and spelling mistake, that is there, not an issue. You need to, whatever you are saying, I should be able to understand. I will not deduct your marks for grammatical or spelling mistake. But if I am not understanding what you are writing, I will not give you marks. So you need to see that you are writing which others can understand. That we will do in the class. When you will write, I will read your answer. I will see what I am understanding. You will also see. So if I am not understanding what you are writing, then marks will not be given. The expected typing speed is roughly around 20 words per minute. 45 minute task would therefore require 675 words. 45 minutes into 75% of the time spent for typing into 20 words per minute. So that we are saying that I will say in simple language, you should be able to type 1.5 lines in 1 minute. From now onwards, these 30 days, don't please write anything on copy pen. Whatever you are studying, whatever you are doing, do on a screen, make your notes on Word file only. Never use copy pen. So that for the exam, you are better well prepared, because this is not selection of correct answer. You need to explain. In case study, there will not be any numerical question. No numerical question. Like suppose consolidation, preparation, balance sheet, goodwill calculation and all that, no numericals. Calculator is actually not required. You can take calculator, but nobody required to use calculator in the exam because there is no numerical. But still the question will be there on consolidation. How you calculate goodwill, why you calculate goodwill like that, that you need to explain. So all the things which you are studying in E1, P1, F1, numericals is not required. You need to have the concept of that. And that concept you need to explain. Suppose you are explaining how goodwill is calculated to an engineer. He has never studied accounts, but you need to explain him so that he can understand. That is your challenge. So everything is explanation, theory. There is no numerical questions. All numerical working they will do. During the exam, on the screen, there is a tab which is written pre-seen. You click that, you will get the pre-seen material there. But generally, when the pre-seen material is already published around 12 days earlier from today, 15 days earlier, because on 22nd it was released. So we understand that the pre-seen material is there before the exam around 40 days. If we don't know what is written in the pre-seen, then we are not well prepared. So for that reason, even the pre-seen material will be there on the screen, but the student should not be requiring to open the pre-seen. He should be very well conversant with the pre-seen material, everything, so that he don't have to open and he will apply his brain on other areas. So as far as planning is concerned, revise E1, P1, F1. Revise means don't go into CIMA Kaplan material. You have my PDF copy. If you don't have E1, we will give you. You just mail, we will give you the E1 PDF money, PowerPoint also. Take a target that in every 7 days you complete one subject. With the seat, just need to have the basic knowledge what is there in the syllabus. So 7, 7, 7, 21 days. In 21 days, along with the other study, you will complete E1, P1, F1 study. You can make, it is 23rd September, but you start with, you can say, today is 9th October. From 9th October, Mimi, you make a schedule that from 9th October till 38th of October, you will be completing this revision of E1, P1, F1. Suppose there are in total, if you go with my PowerPoint slides, there is around in total 600 slides. Every day you need to have a target of 20, 25 slides. So by that you will complete all the readings of E1, P1, F1. Then some time you need to give for looking after the past term papers. That time you can say 2 to 3 hours. Maybe one day you have opened one pre-seen, and on the basis of that, you found what are the questions. You don't open pre-seen, just the questions and answers. Read them once. Then first reading of the pre-seen. We will start reading of the pre-seen today. If you have not started, you need to read on your own. The first reading should be fast. It should be completed 24 pages pre-seen. You should be able to read in around 2 hours. When you do the second reading of the pre-seen, then you highlight some paragraphs within the pre-seen only, not in copy pen. I will show you how to highlight. While highlighting, you can comment something, you can write something. In the third reading, make a notes on pre-seen in the word file, that what is written in different pages, what is the meaning of that. Then we will start questions actually, giving mock papers relating to E1, P1, F1. And you need to answer relating to those mock papers. It is written 5 mocks, I will be giving you 10 mocks. In every class, there will be 2 mocks. And you need to write answers for them. Suppose 10 mocks, it is actually 3 hours each. 30 hour. Then reading the pre-seen will take around 10 hours. Then preparing for E1, P1, F1 will take around 30 hours. We take 10 hour extra. Total is coming 80 hours study. In 30 days, you need to study 80 hour. So every day is coming 2.5 hour. I will say 3 hours. For these coming 30 days, every day we need to study 3 hours. Then nobody can stop us from passing this exam. We will 100% pass this exam. The study of E1, P1, F1 is a regular affair. You will be go on doing that till you can say 25th or 30th October. And then at the end, you will be doing the mock papers, which is purely without referring any material. Kuch bhi refer nahi karna hai, aur answer likh likh ke dena hai. Maybe you are in office, when you come back home, write papers, morning, write papers. You need to study for 30 days properly. Enjoy your life. I am not saying that don't go for roaming and all that in pujas or anywhere. Go. But you have to study every day like you are doing other things. Make a chart from 9th of October till the end that how you will be preparing everything. And follow that chart. Last thing, the exam is around 7th or 8th of October, in November. I don't exactly remember the date. The last date for filling the exam form is around 25th of October. Don't wait for 25th of October. Fill up the exam form by 20th only. Because if you fill up earlier, you will be getting your desired center. And this exam cannot be rescheduled. This exam is not like OTQ exam where you can do rescheduling. Once it is fixed, it is fixed. So the exam form should be filled up within 20th October only, within 10 days. Every term, there are some students, I say in the first class, they forget to fill up the exam form. Once the date is over, you cannot fill up. Whenever is the exam is starting 15 days earlier, you can fill up the exam form. The exam seats Tuesday to Saturday, 5 days, you can select any one day. The date should be selected Thursday, not Friday, Saturday. Suppose you went for the exam and there is some technical problem, load setting or something. You are not able to give the exam. But if you are not able to give the exam on Thursday, you mail the institute, they will arrange Friday or Saturday for you. But if you are booking for Saturday and if some technical issue arises, you will be not be able to give the exam. That term is lost. So for that reason, book your exam on Thursday. give the exam on Thursday so that any problem which is not beyond your control can be tackled. Okay, this is, you can say, basic introduction relating to operational case study exam. Now we are going into studying the pre-seen material. In every pre-seen material of all 17-18 terms, the first paragraph, the first page is this only. Who are you in the company? So this is a company, GymFit company, fitness equipment they have, which people do the exercise and all that, make their body fit and fit. You are in the company a finance officer, because you are the operational level person. You are the finance officer. You are working under finance manager. In managerial level, you will become finance manager. Finance manager works under senior finance manager. So in strategic level, you will become senior finance manager. And senior finance manager report to board of directors. So you are in the lowest level of the organization. Finance officer. What is the job of the finance officer? Managing day-to-day affairs in the organization. Short-term affairs, not long-term. Long-term means you are not thinking about doing something for 5 years, 10 years. That is not your point of thought. You will be managing day-to-day affairs if there is any problem arises relating to any operational areas, HR, marketing, or you can say basic accounting treatment of certain matters. You need to help your finance manager. And at the same time, if there is any issue, because a management accountant knows everything. A management accountant is for that reason studying every area. IT also, HR also, marketing also, decision making also, accounting also, everything you are doing. So you need to help everybody. Whatever is asked for you, you need to help to everybody. Mainly you are working under finance manager. So you are the finance officer of GymFit company. Your main role is support Stephen Porter, the finance manager of the company. Your task include the production of annual budget. When the budget will be prepared, you will be helping the finance manager. Producing the monthly management accounts. At the end of every month, the company is analyzing the performance. That is by variance analysis, by risk analysis, and providing information to management as it is required. You also assist with the preparation of financial statement. When the company's financial statements are being prepared, since you have studied F1, so there may be any issue relating to any accounting treatment, you will be helping them deal with any queries regarding financial reporting. That is your job. Now, suppose you want to write something you want to highlight. I have taken this. Highlight this. But at the same time, I want to write something. Open pop-up. Now there is a pop-up. I can type anything. Post. Done. Whenever I will open this, go on this line, the pop-up, whatever I have typed is here. So first reading, we are not doing this. But when we do the second and third reading, we will be doing that. In second reading, on every paragraph, anything we find that we are not understanding, we will make our notes. And then in the third reading, we will make notes in the Word file. The second and third reading, you will be doing. I am doing the first reading by giving you the holistic view. For that reason, it will not complete today. It will be complete in the next class. Okay. So we are understanding everything, nitty-gritties, the strength, weakness of the company, everything. Or in relation with the different subjects and everything. This role of a finance manager is related with E1. There is a topic finance function in your E1 syllabus. In that, there is a preparation of budget, there is a preparation of financial statements, tax matters, everything. You have in your syllabus in F1 tax also. So what each finance officer do is written in E1, a topic called finance function. But we are understood, we don't have to go into that topic. You are operating at operational levels, and whatever the problem, whatever the issues, whatever the finance manager will ask you, you need to do. If the finance manager may be, say, on a leave for 5 days, you will be holding the position just like a finance manager. And you will be doing the work which finance manager do. So you need to have a knowledge of a finance manager also, so that you will be able to handle. The questions will be relating to all the subjects E1, P1, F1, all the skills. If we write a proper answer, we will get full marks. There is no problem in passing the exam. Generally, your type of student easily pass this exam. Just that they need to work. Whatever I am saying, they need to answer. Otherwise, there is no problem. It is easier than OTQ exam. Because there is no wrong or right. Now they are giving in next page company background. That is GymFit, when it was established, how they are doing the business, some background they are giving. GymFit is a fast growing leading provider of low cost gym and one of the pioneers of low cost gym model, which is based on relatively low gym membership fees and no frill service concept. So GymFit company is providing low cost gyms. That is, if you are getting a membership of this gym, the cost is very low. So they are attracting public on the basis of cost. People enjoy the gyming activity here because of the lower cost. And this is a no frill gym. No frill gym means you will find in a gym wherever the gyms are there. Sometimes they have sauna. They have other activities also. We don't have any other activity. We just give gym facility and some exercises can be done. Other things we don't provide. It now has 102 gyms with 4,86,000 members based in major towns and cities throughout Cultland, Europe. There is no country called Cultland. It's a hypothetical name. There is no company name as GymFit. All people name, place name, everything is hypothetical. But the data are taken from a practical company, maybe mixing two companies. They cannot use the name of the company for whom they have taken the data, because otherwise they will be penalized if something they are writing which is not the case. For that reason, for protecting, the institute use hypothetical name, but all the data are practical. There is a huge analysis done to gather this data. Once we do this case study, you will have a very good understanding about gym industry, how it operates and all that. So you can later on open a project or you can help anybody in a gym industry. So I like this type of study because every 3 months, every quarter, 3 case study I do. I am taking knowledge about 3 industry, because otherwise you busy, I am busy. We are not going to study any industry. But when you will do this study and you will like that, you will find that this is fantastic, excellent way of studying. Not the book is making you more practical. So we are getting knowledge relating to gym activity or gym business. So it has 102 gyms for the time being, and 4,86,000 members are taking the services from those gyms. Based in major towns and cities throughout Cultland, Europe. The company was founded in 2005. So it's around 13-14 years old company. Using finance from venture capitalist. Do you know what is venture capitalist?